Hello, everyone. Colloquium. February 15th. It's our great pleasure and honor to have Eiko Otake with us today. This is Dance Studies Colloquium at Temple University, I should add, and my name is Mark Franco, just so you know who I am. But I'm going to introduce Eiko quickly, and so we can move on to her presentation. Born and raised in Japan and a resident of New York since 1976, Eiko Otake is a movement-based interdisciplinary artist. After working for more than 40 years as Eiko and Koma, in 2014, she began performing her own solo project. In 2017, she launched a multi-year duet project, an open-ended series of cross-disciplinary experiments with a diverse range of artists. In 2022, Eiko started her 10-year project, I Invited Myself, in which she creates, advocates, and exhibits her media works. I Invited Myself, Volume 3, Duets, is now on view at the Fabric Workshop and Museum in Philadelphia until March 24th. For her solo work, Eiko has received a Bessie's Special Citation, an Art Matters Fellowship, the Anonymous Was a Woman Award, and the LMCC Sam Miller Award. Eiko regularly teaches at Wesleyan University, NYU, and Colorado College, where she has recently received an honorary degree in 2020. And with that, welcome and thank you for being with us today.
Lori, are you ready? Yes, I'm going to say a few things. Thank you, Mark. And I hope there are people watching also online. But thank you for those who are here tonight. Not tonight. I'm such a night to be. Not used to do something at 3 p.m. Nevertheless, I took an opportunity. Soon we are March. And every March makes me remember March 11, 2011. So I would like also to mention it is this city, Philadelphia, that I have started my first solo project, which I ended up calling Everybody in Places, because after that I did go to many places, and I will include that video. And what I did was to yesterday night until this morning, I made like first 15 minutes or so. I'll just try to give you a little introduction about myself. And part of that is, of course, as Eiko and Koma. And then I will move on to more focus to the My Fukushima project. And I will show you a very quick, small part of My Fukushima film. But I have made it tighter and much shorter for this occasion, so that I can also show you how I use those photographs and those films I have created. So all together, I hope to show you a different facets of the project. And then I will open with your questions, okay? I have a pretty heavy accent, so if you find hard to understand with these intimate people, just stop me. Or just put it yourself, you can ask me later. Whichever the way you choose is fine, okay? So, Lori, the video will continue to run unless I stop, and then I will talk it over, or I'll be quiet sometimes to give myself a little rest. Okay, here we go. Let's start. So, Carrying Fukushima is the title of my project. And I will first introduce you my parents. And this is August 10, 1945. I often ask my student and my friends, what are the historical event that is important to you, that had formed you, that had a strong effect to your life and to your thinking? And this is 4 days after the Hiroshima atomic bomb, 1 day after Nagasaki atomic bomb, and 5 days before Japan had surrendered. But then 7 years later, which 7 years is a US occupation, US alone occupation of Japan. And I'm introducing my second son, Shin, who had made this film. I paid him $300, and it's a longer film.
Eiko and Yokohama were born in post-war Japan, a very different country from what it is today. Nature was a part of life, and living was simpler without much technology. Children of the baby boom generation could always be seen playing together on the streets and in the open fields. However, the nature around them was rapidly destroyed and replaced by industry and new popular culture.
60s.
Some baby boomers, including Eiko and Koma, protested, their anger filling the streets in the 60s.
University of Tokyo.
It was this seeking of social change and self-exploration that turned Eiko and Koma to dance as an experimental
Hijikata
alternative.
And Kazuo Ono.
After studying with Tatsumi Hijikata and Kazuo
on the
Ono
right
briefly,
is a Kazuo Ono.
They decided to leave Japan to explore the world on their own.
So I'm going to show you a picture that had influenced me at the very beginning of my dancing life. But I'll first speak about why that picture is important to me.
Hijikata-san のところには3ヶ月しかいませんでした。小野先生のところには週2回通いましたが、それも短い間です。
This was made
大きな才能と強い個性の持ち主で若い私は戸惑いました。
I talk about my memories of my youth.
特に大野先生は巨木、とてつもない巨木でした。でも私とコマさんはその時、その木のそばにいたくない、長くいられないと思ったんです。
You're supposed to stay with a great teacher, but I didn't.
小野先生のことは大好きでした。でもそれなのに、またはそれゆえに離れたい。日本の政治状況にも行き詰まりを感じていたので、東京からも離れたい。離れたいという方が先で、じゃあどこに行こうかと考えました。
I'm always leaving.
アメリカはベトナム戦争をしていたのでそこには行けない。ではヨーロッパの方へ行こう。そう思ってナホトカ行きのロシア船に乗りました。
This was when Russia was a USSR. Cheapest way to get to Europe.
そこからシベリア鉄道でカバロフスクとモスクワ、そして飛行機でウィーン。
It took us a week.
それからミュンヘンに着きました。文化センターで見たドイツのノイエタンツの写真が強く心に残っていたからです。
This is about ドアホイヤー。
ノイエタンツの巨匠であったメリー・ウーグマン。彼女は高齢だったので、ウーグマンのアシスタントだった女性のソロダンサー、マニア・シュメールのスタジオに毎日通いました。
I also saw Ugman's photos.
しかしそれも半年間だけです。基本的に私は年月をかけてしっかり何かを習うということをしないできました。
That is why it's very strange I'm here.
だから舞踏という言葉も使ったことはありません。
I take a lot of effort to say I'm not
あちこちでいろいろな経験をしたい。それは自分の問題で誰のせいでもない。自己責任で判断して仕事もしてきました。その始まりのところに文化会館がありました。
So、this is Tokyo downtown.
海外のダンスアーティストの写真を見て、ああ、こういう人が世界にはいるんだ。私はこ こういう人に会いたいんだと思ったんです。
This is right in the middle of the COVID. So that nobody could come to Japan for Olympic. And was the volume okay? Can you hear? Yes, good. I will continue. So I'm reading a letter I wrote to Doa Hoya. Dear Doa Hoya, I saw this photo in Tokyo when I was 20 years old. You are quiet and grounded. You have a quest. I tried to stay in this picture as long as I could. That gave me courage to leave Japan, to start my own journey. Later I learned you killed yourself on December 31, 1967. So I could never meet you. But I saw many of your photos. You are only 56 years old. So this is the day I was leaving Japan, and I arrived to Germany and performed. And after a few years, we made ourselves to come to America. Vietnam War ended by then. Otherwise, we would have not have come. I used to work in a restaurant called Yokohama Triennale. So that's where I had an idea of using unwashed clay. This is our first piece, and we continued to hold that every piece we made during that period of white dance. But I did not know we were supposed to make a piece. I thought I wanted to declare myself, we are not a dark black dance from, that is how the Buddha has been described. And quick forward, after meeting so many downtown friends, I think when I met Marianne there around that time, we were part of the 1980, Creative Time. Just out on the beach, thank you. Because Marianne knows we share the time in New York, we are the same teacher. So you just saw me attacking Wall Street, because this is a landfill that now actually a Stuyvesant High School. This is where on 9/11 day, all the people who are wounded or dead had been carried in. So you see the Twin Tower. I carry white flag, white clothes, just attached to a pole. Because Commander, I do not like any other flag but white flag. And many years later, after 9/11 happened, I searched this video and saw that airplane, and I had a shiver. The white flag means surrender. And surrender, to me, is the ultimate non-violence way. We can still protest, but not use force. And in that way, thinking, it became very important to me that I think about other species. We are so human, we didn't ask to become a human, we happen to become human. I didn't ask to become a female or a Japanese citizen, I happened to be born. So to think about somebody else, different nationality, different place, a different gender, and different species altogether, made me free from my often too human-centric point of view, because we are locked into our humanity. And that also made us to work in a place that is not necessarily a theater. Because theater, human beings perform, human beings watch. Can we go somewhere else? Where we can be human beings doing something, extending our lives to other species, other places.
And downstream. I feel how the water in the river always runs and never stops. It has been running for many years before my life, and will run for a long time after. It brings us in and it brings us out.
Performed in 17 different rivers, ended up me being in hospital two times, coma once, so we don't do that piece anymore.
Water is in our bodies, rivers, sea, wombs, and in our tears. We remember we all have been dancing in water. At the end of the performance, Koma and I drift downstream, swallowed by the river of time. The audience is left with the river.
So in a public place, such as river, we have to be very careful. There's a law, we cannot be naked. So it's only theater or museum, we can be naked. Even with that, I still get in trouble sometimes. And this is a piece we performed naked and titled Naked. We are pretty straightforward in our titling. I have a policy of using simplest words. Like I call it international junior high school English level. I don't want any mythology that people have to look it up. Everything, all the titles are pretty straightforward. So this is a museum. This happened to be a workout center. And we made this piece during our retrospective project, which is between 2009 and 2012. So at that point, Commander, I have been working for a very long time together. And you know what it is. It's difficult to work with somebody so close all the time. We made an argument between like 2 a.m. to 8 a.m. So performing naked for 1 month, 7.5 hours a day, we start before audience comes in, and sometimes no audience comes in, but we still have to start because it's a promise we made. So our hospitality to the people coming in is our preparation of making a set. We made handmade the set. We made a lighting and the sound effect. Minimum, but taking a long time to make. And that way, we can encourage ourselves to be committed. So now I'm moving to Fukushima. So this is a short, really a small cut of my Fukushima film, which is usually 1 hour and 48 minutes. But I have done many different versions, some as long as 7.5 hours, some much shorter, depending on occasions I can share. So this is today's special, only a very small section. It was January 2014, I have gone to Fukushima. As you already read, it was not my first time, it was my second time. So the memory of being there soon after nuclear disaster was very strong, and I really couldn't process it. I happened to teach a class at NYU and Wesleyan university that combines movement work and historical knowledge acquisition. You know, we study about history of atomic bomb or the war violence or anything of the matter that is important affecting this particular group of students, myself included. So I went there because I thought there was such a regret in my mind. How come I've been teaching about atomic bomb and not teaching nuclear plants? I was never pro-nuclear plants. I was always against. I always knew this is fundamentally very dangerous. But dangerous can put your thinking away. I realized it was inevitable to have meltdowns. And in fact, in the history of nuclear plants, there were so many meltdowns we haven't even learned. I told you that this is a station, the 30th Street station is where I first started to perform. And that decision was made in 2013. But I did not know how to do it after so many years working with coma. It was just my desire. I was sitting in a waiting room. This morning I was sitting there too and remembering how I was thinking. How can I perform solo in the station? And I'm realizing so many people are there waiting, are going somewhere or arriving. And I remember the stations I saw in Fukushima after the nuclear plants completely damaged and land around it were damaged and irradiated. So I wanted to go back to Fukushima to really to understand more using my body rather than being there and completely overwhelmed by it. So I asked my historian friend to come with me and we did a number of photo shooting. Obviously, it's not where I wanted to bring the audience. It's very dangerous. I went there because I'm old enough and I can be responsible on my own decision making, but I didn't want to make that to other people. So this is a waiting room on the smallest station and it's madness. I felt the madness I always knew but wanted to look away. It's just the piling as the radiation. It's like, you know, at that point, I thought no train would ever come. Many, many years later, the train is running there now. And it's a big story, and I can't really give all the details, but the government really pushed it, the recovery effort, and contamination was cleaned up, but the landscape and the environment can never completely be cleaned up because of mountains and also rivers and the water, they are still having a really hard time even to take out the smallest amount of the debris from the Fukushima Daiichi. So that is that. And somehow, being there in 2011 made me wanting to make this futon, which I made with my mother. I knew it's going to be cold since we were there in the winter. And this is all the weeds that grew over the train tracks and then dried out for the winter. Japan is famously often earthquaked country, and Japan, of course, is islands. So you put it together, the oceans all around, and earthquake comes the tsunami. We just had one in January 1, and that was right where a new nuclear plant was supposed to be built, and they stopped building it thank God because it had been and could have been another disaster. So after I was there for the first time, during the first trip, I really wasn't so much as a dance artist. I was so upset. And both the photographer and myself were crying. And I had a long time, I really couldn't move. But then by the fifth, sixth day, I began to feel like, oh, why I came here? I should do something. I'm also, we are like getting more far away from the nuclear plants. So that made me to appreciate seemingly a safer place, even though with the wind, you never know. So after that, 6 months later, we thought we should go back. Because going there once, you're just basically overwhelmed. And I didn't really feel I had the full engagement with what I see. I wanted to go back. Sorry, I dropped the mic. You know, seeing what's broken of all what human being has made, I found something. Doesn't that broken sea wall look like a stomach? Didn't all those boats that were broken look like human beings' intestines? I have a new assumption, not a theory, saying maybe, without knowing, humans imitate humans when we make something. And of course, we are mortal. So it makes sense that everything we make breaks. With that notion, and this is your 30th Street Station, I performed there 12 hours. Koma said, Eiko, you are not very humble. Your first solo concert is 12 hours long. I didn't mean to be seen that way. I just wanted to survey and taste different time of a station. So I started at noon to 3. One Friday, next Friday I came back at 3 o'clock and I performed until 6 o'clock, then the next week 6 to 9, and next week 9 o'clock until midnight. And then I left as a Cinderella would leave. I mean, that's a joke. Well, she just left. Another very important discovery on my end is I had a dress rehearsal and I was shocked to realize not many people stopped and saw me. And I've been a performer since I was 20 years old and I'm sort of used to being watched. And there are lots of people during the dress rehearsal and people just passing by. And I go, what the heck? But then I realize I need intentional audience who gives sort of like an invitation, assumption to the other people that they can stop and watch. It's not dangerous. Well, I look pretty crazy. Few times in a different places, ambulance car was called when I was dancing or moving. So talking about Fukushima, what I was showing you is because I wanted to show the whole exhibition of photo in a station. I wanted to connect 30th Street Station to Fukushima stations. Very different. One is gorgeous, the other is so humble, nobody. I couldn't do it. So I did an exhibition at PAFA, which also produced my station performance. And the exhibition went on for 6 months. And then I brought the same idea to the Fullerton Center, which is the biggest subway hub in New York City downtown. And I really didn't like this place. So to the LMCC, Lower Manhattan Cultural Council, which sponsored and produced the River to River Festival, I don't want to do it here. There's nothing beautiful here. But I was told this is a new place, built, and nothing art-related has ever happened there. And so with that asking, I have accepted. And when I was continue to perform in a different places, I get really weird invitations, like, can you perform at the Hiroshima panel, which depicts the August 6th of Hiroshima, which is where atomic bomb was dropped. And I didn't really want to do it. But sometimes you have a good reason to say no. And I hesitated, and I was thinking how to say no, and it was before too late. So I talked to my friends, and then realized I can use my body by choosing which background, because I move in a space. This is something I learned by performing solos or in public places, libraries, hospitals, city squares, And by moving, I can show what I wanted the people to see. And I also did a Fukushima photograph exhibition in the same space as the Hiroshima exhibitions. And so by the time we did winter visit and the summer visit to Fukushima, I had exhibitions. I had exhibitions 8, 9, 10 different places. This one that you happen to see is Chile, Santiago, Chile. And of course, I don't get invited to do the photo exhibition. I get invited to perform in a dance festival because I'm a dance person. You know, there's a kind of field. So I ask them, okay, I'll come to perform, but could I also do the photo exhibition? So it's basically I'm begging them to make this happen. And for that, I will design the photo exhibition, which is basically a choreographing. You know, where the flow, how audience you want, you know, them to experience it. But there are kind of limit of how many pictures you can put. And by then, we had so many photos. So I also made a video. I invited a bunch of poets in Chile and from America, C.D. Wright, a very wonderful, wonderful poet. And she was reciting. Unfortunately, she died the night she went home. So it's a very regrettable, hard memory on my end. So the last thing she did publicly was reciting her poem in my exhibition. I had a feeling then her intent eyes, if it's not a number of people who come to the gallery, I don't always have to work with the quantity of the people. Because you never know who in the audience has a stronger memory, has a stronger relationship to the subject, or maybe they can forget, but would end up an experience later on to remember. So since I don't really have a relationship to the galleries, but I do have a relationship with dance presenting, you know, organizations. So this is Dance Space Project at St. Mark's Church, really good friends of Eiko and Komar, and many dance artists downtown. So I did 24-hour Fukushima exhibition. Why 24 hours? Because they're very busy. I can't really keep the exhibition there. So I only get to do one day. This is during the platform where they were focusing about my performance. So how to make 24 hours active? I asked my friends to perform every hour of the 24 hours. So all of that being done really made me think, and Bill, my photographer, to think it's time to go back to Fukushima. 2016, we were there again working. And this is a Namie town, which is a rather good-sized town, and we couldn't go there. It was really a stop, big stop, in 2014. But 2016, we could go in. So I could really feel the town as deserted. At the same time, now trying to do the contamination, cleaning up the contamination, and trying to find a way if the town can bring back the people. Each bag contains the contaminated material. It's all very strongly irradiated. But those bags are left there, and some of them start to break down. So it is very, my body shrinks by the fear, not the fear to my own body, but the fear of witnessing complete carelessness. Not to say they have other ways, because nobody wants. It's very exhausting, summer heat, and knowledge of contamination, because we can't really measure. I mean, I did bring the counter, but the counter changes, number changes, depending on where you put it. It's higher here than above. And we always drove different sites, and sometimes we go back to the same place in a different season, different process of the cleaning up effort. And please know, unlike Tanobu, the Fukushima and Japanese government decided not to shield the Fukushima Daiichi, but to clean up and take the old debris out. To this day, not even a little bit of debris has been out. I have no idea what to do. So this also makes you realize, maybe, or imagine I'm a very adventure-seeking person. I'm not. I'm really a chicken. I was actually looking at it today. Another way for me to realize bodily, the sea is dangerous. It really brings you something. I was very careful and I was measuring it to feel this was safe for me to be there. And it really wasn't. Another learning. So 2016 was the fifth year. So there were many articles. I also wrote an article, I wrote so many exhibitions and the showing of the videos I have made. But usually after 5 years, nothing is much written until 10th year. And I didn't want me or others to forget. I also teach, so I understand 5 years is a very long time for 18 years old. So I did a 4-hour memorial on the 6th year of the atomic bomb, which had exhibitions. This is St. John's Cathedral on Amsterdam Avenue, 110th Street. I was an artist in residence. And it's a historical building, so I can't really put it on a wall. It's only a little bit in the center where I can put it on the art wall. So I found a way, so this is art wall where I can pin it. I didn't want the photograph to have framed because you end up having reflections. I really wanted the photograph to be the object of the witnessing. So I kind of pinned it everywhere where we are allowed, but so many places we are not allowed. So I put it anywhere I can. And I kind of became not a dance artist, but a person who was obsessed to carry the Fukushima with me. I really, for a very long period of that solo work, I was wearing the same costumes that I was wearing in Fukushima, so that I can remember it more. I can be a little more strong in my involvement. So we also did a learning session, because it's just as important for me, the emotional receiving, emotional sharing is as important, except I really feel the knowledge is important, shareable knowledge. So I combine that between, among, by the different ways, exhibitions, performances. And when I perform with those photographs, the photograph becomes my props, right? But that props is me. It is me in Fukushima. I can hold it. I can show it to the people. I can pass it to the people. Sometimes I could even break it. I like to make a mess. Marian knows. You know why? Because the world is a mess. Oh, so I also was thinking, how could I, as the 2011 moves away from us, as a past, how could I make it closer to our lives? I live in Manhattan, so I went to Indian Point and to shoot photographs, and I did an exhibition that Indian Point and Fukushima are together, side by side. And so, you know, it's so dangerous. Thinking about the terrorist act, it's just Hudson River. I could just throw the bomb. I was there in front of the front and nobody, they looked at me, but nobody asked me question. I could just run in to do something awful. Of course, I wouldn't. But something about so unguarded, something about so matter of factory, it's there, it's scary. So obviously, you see, I did, and Bill always together, we went back. I don't pay him, he doesn't pay me. We are kind of a gift economy. I am with him, I'm committed to be with him. I was committed not to make a video shooting. I would only make a video from still photographs, especially for this project. And he gives me all his knowledge, energy, willingness, but he let me choose photographs myself, and he let me make a video on my own. Of course, I will share it with him, but this is a kind of economy in art making. We can't do it to everyone, but when you have a relationship, not making into the pay or paid business actually has a potential to work in a different way. I wouldn't say artists shouldn't be paid, but I also feel in a time of difficulties, having a trusted relationship, we can continue to work different way. So between he and I, we share so much memories of being there. To go as close as 6 miles. Before, 20 miles was where we could go. And then, little by little, we could go closer. But I still felt I shouldn't be there. Then why I'm there? It's very dangerous, you know. Any project that you feel involved, the project has a life. And even though you have a hesitation, you still end up doing it. In that, I'm no different from engineering people or scientists in the Manhattan Project. The project drives us out of our own comfort zones. Which we tend to think it's a brevity, which we tend to think a great, wonderful thing about humanity, and I don't think so. I shouldn't have been there. I shouldn't be in the water. I shouldn't be having all the scratch of the mosquito and being in the water with the radiation. But once you are compelled, sometimes we forget. We forget our fear. And it's my job to bring my own fear back to my body. got an invitation from Met, Metropolitan Museum of New York. And the invitation was about, Eiko, would you like to perform in Met? 40 minutes will do. You can be in any gallery. Do you want in a Pacific Ocean gallery? Or do you want to be in an Asian gallery? I found it problematic. So I asked, could I bring a video to project together with my performance? And they said, yes, in condition of if I don't project towards artwork. We made a deal, yes. So I have to find a wall that has no artwork, which is not easy. So I moved the projector onto the cart, and I became a walker, not a dancer. I mean, danced a little bit, but just to kind of, you know, satisfy the contract, because I was supposed to give a dance performance. But most of the time, I was pushing and pulling the projector, changing the place, and putting myself in there. The video I edited for that is 7.5 hours, because I asked what's the longest time I can do. Well, the museum is open for 7.5 hours. And I did it in the 3 different branches, Cloister, what used to be the Whitney, you know, the Madison Avenue, I think, and then the Fifth Avenue. So altogether, it's 23 hours and 30 minutes. And I improvised, but I took so long time to make 7.5 hour video, and in my mind, if I structure that 7.5 hours, I know the structure, I can respond to it. So I wasn't really concerned about my movement together, because my main purpose was Met should not be free of Fukushima. I wanted to stain Met's wall with a Fukushima image. This is so far the last time, and it was very devastating. For the first time, I didn't feel like wearing costume anymore. Because the first time I went, I saw those kimono colors under the, you know, the mess or the futon colors. But by the time 2019, the government determination to make everything okay was so overwhelmingly falling and stressful and not sincere. All what I see is the blocks, 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 bricks, bricks, bricks of concrete. Somebody was making a lot of money. And the money, of course, is from national budget. I get angry, I get sad. I wanted to say no. Not knowing saying no would ever make anything. But when you feel so strongly to no, we cannot swallow it. No! If it's only for myself to remember, if it's only about talking about it with friends, with you, there are certain occasions in life where you just feel so strongly, angry, devastated, wanted to say no. And I believe that. Something if we can't ignore, because if we ignore that, we are no longer the same person that I thought I was. So this is a kind of wrap-up. So 2021, the Tokyo Olympic happened without audience coming from abroad. And I dislike Olympics, and I told the organizers, but I also appreciated the occasion where I could work making a film. So what I chose to do is to project Fukushima image into the Tokyo's walls and buildings. Because it is Tokyo, which I'll speak soon, so I just shut up. You heard me enough.
10年前に福島でメルトダウンがありました。
Could you bring up a little volume?
福島が作ってきた電気は、東京の人たちがたくさん使ってきた電気です。
This is one of the oldest subway stations of Tokyo, probably even in Asia. And I wanted to project Fukushima underground. I edit all my Fukushima film. One, it's from photos. I can choreograph the photos. Also, it doesn't cost me if I am the editor. And it was important for me that I can really struggle with it. And not making a quick decision because I'm concerned about how much money I'm paying to the editor. So I just go over many, 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 many nights trying to really see what each photograph could bring, selecting. So this is 10 years after Fukushima, and as I said, for 18 years old, that's a long time ago, especially for American youth, even for Japanese youth. For our generation, that feels like just a short while ago, and that gap is healthy, but still most important things has to be told. Either with words or without words or mixing both. So Fukushima made me to use words and I didn't no longer wanted to just make an abstract dance. I need to examine the words.
私は生きることが大好きで、元気ねとよくみんなに言われます。生きることが大好きだということは、死にたくないということでもあるので、その意味では死ぬ準備はしなくてはいけないと思っています。私は死ぬ稽古の一つとして踊っている気もします。
I'm still working. I'd like to continue to work.But selecting what is important to me. I like to be on the floor. I like to go down, down, down. I don't want to go down and get up. I like noise. I don't like music anymore. Suddenly, I don't need it.Hello! This is a basin my mom used. I like to use the same I ever paid for. So I don't see the price tag attached. My mom's chemise, my mom's basin, somebody gave me that hose, dirty, used. It helps me linger. My body becomes bigger because it lingers. That is University of Art. It's a national university of art.
よく考えるのは境界線。外にいる人から中を見るとどう見えるのか。また外にいる人はもしかしたらそこに中があることは考えないで通り過ぎていってるかもしれない。この外の明るいところにいることに慣れている人はちっともこれが眩しいと思わない。でも今私はやっと出てきたので。
Where do I place my body?
そんなふうに日本を出た私が日本を見る。
What is my
アメリカに住んでいる私がアメリカを振り返る。
What do I carry?
中から見る世界と外から中を見る世界。その違いやそのダブっている場所のことを考えます。
I like to be miserable. She's miserable. Okay, this is the last piece.Where I talk about
長い間コマさんとエイカンドコマとしていろいろな作品を作ってきました。
My jacket?
劇場も多かったけれども野外でも美術館でも公演しました。
This belong to my friend who died.
でも一人で何かをやりたいと思い始めてその時に劇場で一人で立つということはどうしてもドラマチックな盛り上がりがいると思ってそれを私が一人でやることはできないなと感じました。
I found it was difficult to get that green.
ソロダンサーの劇場公演を見るたびに、これは私がしたいことではないと感じてもいたんです。それで2011年に福島に行ってから少しずつ考え始めて、そうか、劇場じゃないところ、劇場に来ない人たちがいるところ、図書館とか病院とか食堂とか洋服屋さんとかで踊ろうと思ってそう始めました。
I performed in 78 different places.
もう年を取ってきたから綺麗な照明をかけて自分を隠していくのではなく逆にありのままの姿を晒していこうかなと思っています。76年にアメリカに行ってからこんな風に東京の劇場じゃないところで一人で踊るのは初めてです。カメラが回っていなくてもここでは行き交う人がいるから私が何もしていないよりは何かをしていた方が人々の目に何かが触れれば誰かが何かを感じてくれるかなと思うんです。今日は変な人が何かやってるよなと見てもらえれば日常生活の中で人の罪にならないで人を怪我させないで何か面白いことが起こるそういうことが起こり得る許容できるそういう社会の方が良いと私は思っているのでそれを絶やさないためにもこうして街角で踊ります。
Thank you. The video was 1 hour and 2 minutes, so that I make a video so I never run longer than I was expected to run. That was my scheme. sorry. Okay. Do you have questions? Do you want to entertain me with your questions?
That was wonderful, Eiko.
Well, you have to say something other than wonderful. My that, friend dear.
That was wonderful, Eiko.
The people online can't have asked questions, so somebody who is here. I mean, I'm not forcing you, by all means.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your... Thank you, so are you. Thank you so much for your work. And usually when the lights are on, I can write down and remember things, so I'm going to try to do the best that I can do. So it looks like in your story, you really was doing some moving. You kept moving and moving and moving. And it looks like, but it looks like it was a lot of sorrow and suffering, and I guess that was because of the nuclear plants. And one of the things that I did like that I saw you do was, I believe, different places like train stations that you visit. You was doing a performance, and it was more so it was historic because you wanted people to remember what had happened. But in times, it seemed like things have gotten a little better, but your dance, your feelings never got any better. And actually, I was wondering why. That's one of my questions. And then seeing all of the struggles that you have went through and the sorrow, how does that make you stronger today? Sometimes when people go through a lot, it makes them stronger in the future. Can you tell me a little bit about that, please?
That is a great question. My friends tease me, Eiko, don't you ever do happy, happy dance? Well, I don't. Because I work as a performing artist, and I also see who is my audience and what my work could provide something. So I see no reason someone in America, for example, need another happy dance, somebody else can do it much better. You know, I see my colleagues work. So to the degree I am curating, that something, and part of my curation is insistence. And part of insistence is you do one thing, and do you graduate from that? So what happened? How important you felt about it? So the only way, without hiring a humongous agency, which I don't, I choose to dare repeat what's important to me, but not necessarily repeating the way I do it. So as you can see, the Fukushima project was never exactly the same way as I started to do a photo exhibition. I forgot to tell. This heavy book, this was published in 2021. So I never thought about writing. This is artist book, only me and my photographer writes. There is no another important person, just us book. I never thought about doing this the first time I started to work with Fukushima. So as I continue, I either widen, deepen, twist, and that still I feel the need to say more. I feel the need to go back. I feel the need of finding other knots. And I desire to know more. Thank you for what you are saying. It looked better. Okay, what does that look mean, right? There are still so many garbage dump, which is all nuclear irradiated. And to this degree, originally TEPCO said about 45 years it will take to clean up, right? And now it's already, now we are 2024, so it's already 13 years later, not even a Q-tip full of debris has been taken out. And when I keep presenting it, I keep myself a task of keeping up the information, right? So I need that binding, right? So I hope that I'm not saying the same thing as I said in 2014. But to the degree, I can't, and I'm 72, and I can't really do 29 other things in the rest of my life. So I don't think I will only work about Fukushima Mata, because Fukushima Mata is not isolated, right? It's just another mountain which is connected, right? So I choose to stick to it to the degree where I feel I can tell the stories. Now, there are different ways to tell the stories, right? So performing is one, talking is one, writing sentences is the other, just having a conversation is the other. Another part, as a performer, we never want people to go back home saying, oh, that was boring, we never want to go back again. My job is to keep it, and hopefully, a little sting, like, oh, but there's something there. Why is Eiko being so serious about it? Because it is a serious matter. So only I'm adding, not a value, but a seriousness of it. And this is what I choose to do as my artist life. Now, in a real life, I'm actually quite funny. So I see no reason why I should be funnier on stage. I don't need that to myself. Anybody else? Well, thank you for asking that question.
Okay, so thank you so much, Eiko. Actually, I saw your movie last year in the winter, The No Role Is Our Rule. With
thank you for seeing that. We showed it at Asian Art Institute.
Oh, and yeah.
Asian Art Institute. Sorry, yes.
Yes, yes. Just by thinking about, you mentioned how naming your pieces as like a not very like a illegible way of naming your piece. So I'm thinking about that piece because obviously naked is like your word not staying on stage. So how about that one, the no rule is our rule? Like, what do you mean by that?
No rule is our rule means no rule could be your intention to make your life as close as no rule as possible, but to observe the situations and being able to adapt rather than changing your rule, right? So yes, it is a little more complicated. It's a full sentence rather than rule, right? But still, I keep the promise. It is a junior high school English. Right? I mean, no words is particularly difficult. But I do appreciate, what does that mean? No rule is our rule, right? Because there are so many rules here as we live in, right? So can we counteract by having a little, not a chaos, what is the word I'm looking? Anarchy. Can we keep some anarchy as our life force so that I don't become smaller and smaller and smaller, right? So in the morning, sometimes I feel like, just to keep, I'm not hurting anyone. It's a little disgusting, but it just makes me to know whatever the little control we can have, but we have an act of acting, whether it's screaming, or whether it's crying, or whether it's delivering the message. So yes, no rule could be, if not a rule, no rule could be our desire, so that we can follow our thoughts and the possibilities. You know, my writing designer and technical director always laughs at me because every time I arrive to the theater, I open every door, whether it's on stage or from the corridor, because I like to see what's in there. And I get scolded by that, right? So now I ask, can I open this door? And often the answer is no. And I said, why? What's in there? I don't want to just be on the stage to understand what's the capacity of this room. Who owns it? Who makes the rules? Can I kind of be a little more inquisitive than just following the rules and be a good citizen?
In that connection, I had a question, but you almost seem to be talking about it already. What is the relation between this devastated place, which is dangerous, which you repeatedly go back to and work in, and the public spaces, whether they be train stations in Philadelphia or museums or subway stations in New York. I mean, there must be some, I mean, obviously there are spaces to perform in, but what is the deeper thought of why these things go together in some way, or do you have any ideas about that?
Okay.
One, there are places where you only get to learn by being there, and that doesn't only mean Fukushima. There are certain places you just realize, like holy moly or shit or my God or whatever, you know, maybe none of that, maybe just like, and that memory, we need to activate it, because just like any other memory, sometimes it fades away. I too get buried and busied with emails, whatever. So it's important for me, if I decided this is important, I have to keep asking, is it still important? One. Two, I am the one performing, being produced often, but when I'm here, I like this, not only Mark welcoming people, but I welcome people. So I'm not like borrowed cats that Mark just picked up and put on a stage. So in order to do that, I need to own the subject matter. I need to own, not by money, but my insistence and my willingness. So I want to say to the audience, thank you for coming back. If you have a problem, you tell me what your problem is, so I can learn. So I have to bring in something that is solid, that we can have a conversation about. And something solid and dangerous. And what's most important to me about the nuclear plants, which I believe is one of the most fundamental environmental crises, together with atomic bomb, because that's so together. You know, every nuclear plant actually prepares plutonium. So even Japan does not have a nuclear bomb. If Japan ever wanted to make a nuclear bomb, it's very easy because they have a lot of plutonium, right? It's existential. It's philosophical. It's political. It's environmental. And it's always, human has done Pandora's box. It's something we can't disregard because we have done it. But somehow I hope we refuse to be. I want to have it with me, so that if people don't remember, younger people don't remember what a shock I have, and so many more people, had March 11 of 2011, or rather also many other occasions, 1945, September 11, 2001. Like, how can we make so we can continue to learn, but not be depressed and minimizing ourselves and be self-loathing and be kind of praying, right? So the place we live is not praying, our body is not praying. We have so many not pocket, you know, like wrinkles. And I feel like some of my wrinkles has a very strong memory, and I wanted to put it there, right? So if I'm cooking you a dinner, I don't want to buy the dinner in a supermarket. I want to cook it for you, right? And I would like to make sure that something that you are eating in my house is not something you eat it every day in your own house. Not that I make a lot of money, Now, not that I spend lots of money to make something really exotic, which I avoid, but there's something as me inviting people to be in front of me, that I need to bring something that I have thought long enough, that I continue to think. And it just bind my body in a way, but I need to kind of, you know, I need to be staying tall. But at the same time, I could really feel the pain. And this is something, it always has been the way I walk. And I cannot be much different. Any complaints?
Hello, thank you for your wonderful piece. I really enjoy it. My question is, I can see the intimacy between you and the fabric. So my question is, what is the intention? Like you bring these fabrics into the like performing location. So yeah, I want to know that. Thank you.
Yeah, I made the video so tight, I didn't really have time to say. So when I saw Fukushima 2011, 5 months after the nuclear disaster happened, you know, the tsunami came, so make everything very dusty, and everything is like, right? I mean, this is nothing, right? I just tried to. So underneath of it, all those stuff is those colors. You know, the comforter, for example, or futon, which often comes from the kimono colors. Because when the kimono started to get a little old, people would make something like this. And I remember seeing this, and it probably belonged to the generations of people who already died. Because in a contemporary Japan, people don't wear kimono all the time in everyday life, right? So I really thought about, I can't pretend that I could be a speaker about the people who live there and who had to flee. They have their own mouths, they have their own brains to talk about their stories. So my feeling was, could I talk to the tree? Could I walk on the mountain? Could I be in a shrine, even though I'm not religious at all? How does the shrine continue to observe? And how do we feel the people who were there long ago? Because in Japan, family has a graves, and often graves had been broken down because of tsunami, and then kept broken down because of the radiation. So to the degree I was getting a hint from what I saw, the colors. And this is usually the inside of the kimono colors. Right? So I made a huge red fabric, hand sewed. After how many years, I lost it. So now I don't have it anymore. So this is a small piece. But I have this. So to me, carrying it is a commitment. And I let my student touch it, right? And you have a relationship, right? So it's not only in your head. And I chose this fabric, right? And, almost instinctively, right? So you got me sewing it. You know, this purple color? In Japan, purple is an important color because also emperor's household has this color, which I don't approve. But the purple has many different purples. So you can actually see, putting it together, I have a different, you see that? Different purples, right? So by accepting in my household, and I have not paid for any of this, I bought this, which is lingerie, but what I'm wearing here is my mom's, right? And it's important for me that we just can't always be complaining about how artists need money. I need the money to eat, and I need the money to sleep. But I'm trying to find a way where my work is not relied on how much money I spend to make a better work. So I'm very determined not to spend any more money than I need to, so that I can survive and can continue to work. So with that practical reasons and aesthetic reasons, and my memory kind of leads me. This belonged to a really close friend of mine who died. So I don't have to tell to my audience, but it somehow it carries me more than Eiko Otake who had a breakfast this morning. And I would rather wear this than telling you what I ate in my morning. Make sense? Probably doesn't, but that's okay. That's all what I can tell you. Yeah. Anything else?
Hi. Hello.
Yeah.
Hi. Thank you very much. When I see your work, I see an artist that take her heart and bring to the audience, and put in her hand and bring to the audience, is that I feel. And I was thinking if you, I don't know your opinion, if you think that we are for giving that, doing things with love. I was thinking also about how important is also the compromise that an artist have to developing with or practice or thing that are important in political way or in social way or in representation way. The third part was like, I don't see you afraid or tired, you know? It's like you are out of all that. Not sure.
But my student actually jokes to me, Eiko, you have too much energy. And that's actually not true, but I have the personality of being too much.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm very aware of this. So I need performance, because if I sprinkle all my too muchness everyday life, I think I would exhaust my friends. Mm. So I need the performance time where I didn't prepare, to be honest. Mm. This morning around 4 a.m., I was like trying to find what can I fit in here, right? And because I don't have red anymore, so I wanted to bring this. And to the degree, it just makes me able to carry. So it's not about I have this or I have that. It's just how do I get the help that I can carry the content, right?
Mm-hmm.
And not going into this price tags and the budget. So it's like, how can I do no rule until this 4 a.m.? But then I trusted, well, to the degree, and you saw how much I'm not in a sync. But it's okay because I was determined not to make, you know, when you do the PowerPoint, you always get longer because you're always stopping, go to the next, right? And so I'm very capable of doing that. And if talking to you and hearing your thoughts and the questions are just as important. So I was very clearly, I was cutting it 1 hour, right? So sometimes I had to hurry up.
Mm-hmm.
But this is, I prepared this video, and then what I do with it, I kind of left it at the last minute. But that's just the way how the preparation gives me the time to be a little more spontaneous. So the preparation does not kill my spontaneity, I hope. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if I'm addressing.
It's okay, perfect.
Well, the last words.
I think we're and we have the end of the time, but I just wanted to say what you did with that space and with the costume elements and with the images and the way you melded into it was extraordinary. I just thought it was fantastic. And I was thinking at the time, where did you plan that in timing? Why did you go at that time and not? But it was extraordinary. Thank you so much.
I just didn't want to carry two suitcases. That's all what I knew.
Well, brava, and thank you so much.
Thank you very much. This is my first time I do dance department colloquium. I never attended one either. So I was going to excuse myself saying that at the beginning, and I have managed to forget. So thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you. You've reinvented the colloquium.
Thank you. Appreciate it.